Selamat malam. Hari ini saya mulai dengan sebuah kejutan baru, yaitu berbincang dengan Steven Januar. Steven Januar ini orang yang hebat sekali. Nah, ini udah ada Stevennya. Mari kita bergabung. Nah, here you go. Now I
Kelihatan
can
ya,
see
Pak?
you. Ya, kelihatan. Wah, ini pakai baju resmi ya. Lagi di kantor.
Ya, di kantor.
Apa kabar, Steven?
Baik-baik.
Wah, ini kalau di kantor meskipun ini di kantor atau di rumah? Di kantor ya?
Di kantor lagi apa break siang.
Jadi di sana tidak mengalami apa tidak ke kantor atau work from home atau semua orang ke kantor gitu ya?
Di Itali, work from home-nya dia karena waktu itu benar-benar strict lockdown. Jadi Maret, April, Mei itu full at home. Terus Juni mulai dibuka, tapi tentunya dengan catatan, dengan restriksi. Kalau yang punya ruangan sendiri, work from office, yang di common area 50-50 karena mereka pakai masker. Kita pun yang di dalam ruangan kalau lagi ada tamu harus wajib pakai masker, makanya saya harus selalu standby masker sendiri. Tapi ya semenjak September masuk setelah summer holiday lebih relax, lebih bisa full in the office. By default should be in the office kecuali orang tua yang memang anaknya juga masih school from home dan sebagainya. Tapi karena sekolah sekarang juga sudah full open ya sekolahnya.
Oh, oke. Okay.
Ya.
Tapi karena mereka berhasil lockdown sih ya, gitu ya. Jadi
Iya, dan angkanya sih memang belakangan agak naik, tapi selama istilahnya angka kesakitan dan kematiannya rendah, kayaknya sih diupayakan nggak, jangan sampai ada lockdown lagi gitu, karena kan
Iya.
imbas jutaan manusia ya.
Okay, well anyway, Steven, it's such an honor kamu ikutan mau ngobrol dengan kita-kita ini. Dari ngobrol di awal aja saya, I'm so inspired by you and I want to share the inspiration to a lot of people yang udah bergabung. Ini ada a dream me soul, nggak tahu ini mungkin nama yang baru gitu ya. Tapi ada Kwekik, ada Ayeska, ada Edo, ada Adeline. Adeline ini teman bersama-sama di komunitas. Dia senang sekali melakukan kegiatan-kegiatan untuk kemanusiaan ya, Adeline. Alright, anyway, mungkin cerita ya, who are you dan buat teman-teman ini mungkin ini siapa nih Steven Januar gitu kan ya. So why are you in Italy gitu ya? Ngapain dia di Italia ini sekarang gitu kan? Lulus kuliah tahun berapa ya?
Saya
S1-nya
tadinya
S1-nya.
di Indonesia, lalu kuliah Fakultas Kedokterannya dari 2001 sampai 2007. Tapi pada saat yang saya sama saya ngambil master bisnis, jadi lulus hampir bareng. Bisnisnya 6 bulan kemudian di 2018, 2008. Setelah itu ke Jakarta untuk masuk ke industri korporasi.
Okay.
Jadi setelah lulus jadi dokter, saya punya private clinic di Jakarta, tapi pada saat yang sama juga dengan background bisnis saya, kebetulan akhirnya saya masuk ke dunia korporasi. Pak Victor, kebetulan waktu itu Bayer, kita tahu salah satu world's biggest company, biopharmaceutical company dari Jerman, looking someone untuk lead dermatology bisnisnya dia. Jadi saya gabung di Bayer dari 2008, selama lebih kurang 3-4 tahun, lalu ke Boehringer Ingelheim, dan akhirnya ke Menarini di Singapura, lalu kemudian 5 tahun kemudian diajak pindah, bukan disuruh pindah sih, diajak pindah ke Italia. 2 tahun di Eropa, jadi ya lumayan seru lah, maksudnya lebih kurang dalam 15 ya, hampir 20 tahun pengalaman di healthcare dan biopharmaceutical, saya bisa menjajaki pengalaman baik di country level, regional level, maupun global level sekarang. Jadi ya senang bisa sharing lah gitu.
Wow, amazing. Jadi lebih banyak menjadi dokternya atau lebih banyak menjadi bisnismennya ini?
Sebenarnya sih mencoba untuk balance Pak Victor, karena kita tahu kadang yang namanya healthcare bicaranya service, objektif, first, the side commercial aspect gitu. Tapi di sisi lainnya, kalau kita bicara dari sisi bisnisnya, every company they launch new product, they launch new drugs, they launch new medical device, they launch harus making profit, harus making money, deliver benefit for the patient, but at the same time deliver also profit for the company. Jadi makanya saya sih mencoba balance di keduanya, Pak. Kebetulan makanya saya juga dokter juga, tapi di bisnis juga ya. Mudah-mudahan bisa membantu membalance kedua sisi ya kan.
Malah bisa membayangkan karena being a medical doctor yang memikirkan tentang obatnya gitu kan, jadi seeing the connection between what people should use atau should prescribe dengan you as a background of a medical doctor itu kan sangat sangat bantu gitu ya dalam konteks itu. Tapi seeing you gitu ya, apalagi baru lulus tahun 2007 gitu, very young ya. And what makes you being the young and striving into the international. Ini kebetulan kan atau memang punya mimpi mau kerjanya di international and being an international person or what is your aspiration sebetulnya?
Aspirasi saya sebenarnya sih mulainya sih Pak waktu kalau saya boleh agak retrospektif sedikit, sebetulnya inspirasinya juga salah satunya dari mentor saya gitu. Kebetulan waktu itu saya lagi studi Master Business itu, salah satu mentor saya, Pak Adrian Sudibyo bilang, Steven, kamu tahu nggak kenapa healthcare di Indonesia itu istilahnya banyak room for improvement, ya kan? Yang perlu diperbaiki. Intinya dia bilang, karena banyak dokter kadangkala memikirkan treatment, mengobati pasien, treat satu-satu-satu, disembuhkan gitu, tapi kadang dalam konteks manajemennya, manajemen in overall, manajemen kebijakan, policy, yang satu kebijakan bisa influence berbagai aspek begitu kan. Sehingga menurut dia, kalau dokter juga ngerti manajemen, rasanya akan lebih baik gitu. Nah buat saya itu menjadi apa ya, menjadi pemecut gitu ya. Jadi seperti booster spirit untuk, bener juga gitu kan. Jadi memang being a doctor yang ngerti manajemen itu menurut saya penting juga gitu. Makanya akhirnya saya situ, dan ketika saya kerja juga akhirnya saya masuk ke istilahnya pharmaceutical, mendeliver solusi, mendeliver obat, mendeliver kesehatan bagi pasien, tapi pada saat yang sama juga bicara tentang manage gitu kan, baik itu memanage campaign, memanage product life cycle, memanage launch, sampai memanage P&L company yang tentunya bicara menghidupi ribuan pegawai gitu. Jadi makanya itu dua sisi, tapi terus menginspirasi saya, dan saya kebetulan cukup beruntung misalnya memulai dari company yang boleh dibilang cukup besar, infrastruktur edukasinya sangat bagus, one of the world leading gitu, sehingga akhirnya dari situ karirnya terus dididik, dibangun, dididik, dibangun gitu. Tapi kembali lagi sih menurut saya Pak Victor, kembali lagi ya itu pentingnya seseorang yang juga kembali lagi memfasilitasi ya kan. Kita tahulah bahwa kita boleh pintar, kita boleh punya ilmu, kita boleh punya akademis, kalau nggak ada yang memfasilitasi, nggak ada yang memberi kesempatan, nggak ada yang menjawab apa yang dibutuhkan untuk be at the next level, untuk climb to the next level, itu nggak akan nyampe juga gitu. Jadi makanya sih menurut saya kombinasi dari berbagai hal sehingga akhirnya saya terus dikasih kesempatan, difasilitasi untuk bisa jump to the next level, kamu butuhnya apa, sebagainya. Jadi makanya saya ingat banget waktu saya masih 28-29 tahun, saya sudah jadi head of marketing untuk seluruh Indonesia gitu. Itu posisi tertinggi marketing di sebuah negara gitu, dan negara Asia Tenggara paling besar. Makanya pada waktu itu saya pikir, my next step apa gitu, karena kita bicara saya biasanya boleh dibilang termasuk yang termuda untuk di jabatan sedemikian gitu. Sehingga makanya pada waktu itu saya fasilitasi dengan internal human resource department, saya juga bilang bahwa kalau ada kesempatan izinkan saya belajar beyond Indonesia. Beyond Indonesia artinya regional. Nah, akhirnya kemudian difasilitasi, diberi kesempatan, diberi project untuk involve yang namanya Center of Excellence Media untuk Southeast Asia plus Korea. Nah, disinilah mulai ada responsible regional, meskipun regionalnya di-manage dari Jakarta, di-manage dari Indonesia, tapi regional position, karena semua media di seluruh Southeast Asia, Korea pada saat itu harus melalui saya dulu untuk bisa approval, gitu kan. Dan itu mulai ada expanse ke responsibility, dan kalau memang itu terlaksana dengan baik kan akhirnya diberikan next step-nya lagi gitu, sampai akhirnya ada yang menawarkan kamu pindah aja ke Singapura, karena kalau bicara regional position ya memang basis di Singapura gitu, karena itu tempatnya office. Makanya tahun 2013 akhir saya memutuskan pindah ke Singapura. Akhirnya sama terulang lagi, diberi kesempatan awalnya dari satu therapeutic area, ditambahin satu therapeutic area lagi, sampai akhirnya saya jadi director termuda untuk seluruh Asia Pasifik. Pada waktu itu saya 32-33 tahun, sudah jadi director Asia Pasifik untuk jadi responsibility nambah menurut saya, tanggung jawab tambah, tapi karena menurut saya kembali lagi ada orang yang memberi kepercayaan, ada yang memfasilitasi untuk kita bisa go to the next level. Dan akhirnya terus berkembang sampai akhirnya kemudian setelah sukses membangun regional, ada project global dan mereka minta saya pindah ke headquarter, kebetulan karena saya kerja sekarang di the biggest Italian biopharmaceutical in the world, jadi ya basisnya di Italia sekarang gitu.
2018 itu ya?
Ya, saya prosesnya pindah dari 2018 akhir, officially saya mendarat di Italia Januari 2019, tanggal 6.
Dan ya. Itu umur 36, 35?
35, ya.
35. Amazing, amazing, luar biasa ini. Tuh, sampai banyak yang ngasih hati gitu ya, ada Andika. Andika adalah salah satu orang muda yang sangat saya suka jadikan contoh juga sebagai inspirasi ini. Now Andika ketemu sama Dr. Steven ini, I can imagine the two of you talk. Andika di pertanian, kalau Dr. Steven di kesehatan. Beautiful, beautiful. Wah, ada Artika Sadewo, thank you for coming Artika. Ini ada teman-teman muda yang ngeliatin Dr. Steven dan langsung being inspired right away. 33 tahun, 35 tahun sudah berada di international menjadi directors. Imagine ya. Beautiful. Nah, Doc, kalau melihat proses ini, then you said it several times, fasilitasi ya, difasilitasi oleh beberapa orang sehingga mempunyai kesempatan. Besides that kind of facilitation, I want to start asking about the facilitation that I know, which is memfasilitasi meeting atau memfasilitasi ideation of thoughts gitu ya. How do you experience this gitu? Wah, ini yang ngasih hati banyak sekali ya. Ada Eri, ada Patrick, ini pasti senang mendengarkan Dr. Steven nih.
Yeah,
share me more. Like yesterday, you share about this facilitation and how important is it fasilitasi di dunia bekerja, terutama di international companies seperti Minarini seperti ini, atau bahkan sejak di Bayer, di Bollinger juga, Dr. Steven merasakan bagaimana pentingnya para fasilitator sebetulnya berfungsi gitu kan. Both internal and external facilitators gitu. Share with these friends of us untuk ngelihat gimana sih perannya fasilitator gitu kan?
Iya. Yeah. Jadi kalau menurut saya sih, kalau saya boleh sharing dari real experience saya gitu ya. Kita tahu bahwa kalau misalnya kadang kan being at the country level dan being at the global level itu ada boleh dibilang mungkin kayak beda. Ya bukan conflict of interest, cuma beda, saya boleh bilang balutan cerita dalam bisnis komersial, gitu kan? Kalau karena kita tahu bahwa ketika kita berada di country level, biasanya maka main objective kita adalah deliver revenue, baik top line, manage in the middle, dan in the end bottom line. Nah, sehingga untuk memanage expectation, maka biasanya kalau kita ada di country level, Pak Victor, kita kan cenderung untuk memanage, wah, business is tough, you know, very challenging year, you know. So, jadi biasanya memanage, saya akan mencoba memanage expectation bahwa as if, for example, ketika saya mempromise KPI saya 10% growth, itu udah luar biasa banget, gitu kan. Tapi sementara, kalau kita berada di posisi, let's say, global atau regional, objektif kita kan tentunya memotivasi, memprovide extra booster to the country, maka kita bicaranya biasanya super optimistic, like, oh, the future is bright, growth double digit, kegar, it's promising, just launch. Jadi balutan, jadi, nah, kebayang yang satu mencoba menarik untuk over, be super optimistic, tapi yang satu juga akan mencoba untuk memanage expectation bahwa, hey, it's not easy. Nah, kalau ini tidak difasilitasi kan, Pak, jadinya berantem kan? Yang sering kejadian kan begitu. Di beberapa business meeting kita lihat, akhirnya yang country, loh, yang jalanin bisnis siapa? Kamu apa saya? Nah, sering kali jadi begitu. Karena tidak ada yang menjembatani ini begitu. Sementara si global mikir, eh, kamu baru knowledge-nya satu negara aja sudah, istilahnya, sok tahu. Saya sudah ngelihat 80 negara. Saya udah launching di 13 negara. Jadi kayak ada tarik-menarik kan antara dua perspektif yang berbeda. Dan itu sangat umum, baik itu kita di country level, regional level, global level, bahkan di dalam sesama global level, interdepartment pun pasti punya perspektif berbeda. Nah, ketika perspektif berbeda ini menurut saya ada baiknya, maka peran si facilitator itu, kalau saya rasa, makanya di dalam industri kita, Pak Victor, kita juga banyak menggunakan facilitator, baik dalam meeting internal maupun meeting eksternal, karena ya, kalau menurut saya ada tiga esensi sih, Pak. Gitu. Contoh aja kita running sebuah advisory board. Kita tahulah ketika kita mau launching sebuah produk pharmaceutical, kita biasanya bikin expert panel group, gitu kan. Involving profesor dari US, profesor dari Europe, profesor dari Asia Pasifik. Ini tiga profesor aja, background beda, sudut pandang beda, bisa. Istilahnya, contoh kan untuk saya, I know better than anyone in the world, kan gitu. Jadi, jadi kebayang kalau kita duduk di satu table dengan 3-8 expert panel dari berbagai negara, berbagai benua berbeda, itu untuk menyamakan, untuk menuju satu tujuan kan susah, Pak, gitu. Nah, itu menurut saya cuma bisa di-achieve oleh peranan seseorang yang bisa menjadi facilitator, dalam artian karena kalau kita lihat fungsinya, menurut saya, facilitator itu tiga peran utama sih, Pak. Ini dari pengalaman saya pribadi.
Excuse me. Seems there are two people coming from out of Indonesia. Now you switch to English. There are three things. Sorry, there are some friends who are coming from Dubai and from Hong Kong. So I want you to share the in English. Yes, sir.
Okay, so from my perspective, when managing this different perspective, different background, different, I would say, interests, right? I think there are three, I would say, super important elements, the role of facilitators in this sense, right? So the first one, I would say, it's really like to build the bridge, like what I've mentioned before. Someone at the global level like me, for example, we tend to be super optimistic, boost the spirit, track them up and everything, while our colleagues, affiliates at the country level, tend to speak more on a managing expectation. You know, it's we don't want to be overpromised, we want to be realistic, make sure everything is achievable. So, nah, ketika ada dua poros yang beda begini, maka, so the best part is really to build the bridge, ya kan? So that, and if, for example, okay, let's go to, let's say, that way. Okay, the objective is clear. We want to achieve that number. But to achieve that objective, we know that the road is never smooth, right? Mm. Oh, there is a challenge. There is this hurdles. There is, you know, there is a valley that we cannot cross. I think the purpose of the facilitator is really this. So if the facilitator is someone like, okay, if you see this challenge, why don't we do this? Why don't we do that? Why? What if we think like this? What if we think that way? So that's why the other two components, so one is really about building the bridge. But the second one, I think it's objectivity. And the third one is about fresh perspective, because we know that being someone inside, right, we tend to be very subjective, right? Because I see this business, I see this problem every day in my life. So sometimes we lose the objectivity, right? Because I feel that I know you very well. I know me very well. So the subjectivity is very strong. So during this meeting, usually then there is a push and pull, right, between these two perspectives that we need to manage. That's why facilitator could really give an objective perspective from outer of the company or someone out from this any conflict of interest, like my example before. So if we have like three professors representing three continents, one from US, one from Europe, and one from Asia Pacific, having facilitator who's objective out from these, and you know, like even sometimes we intentionally organize the meeting in the country where it's neutral, because if we organize this meeting in the United States of America, then the professor from the US is like, hey, this is my hometown, eh? I know this better than anybody else. So the objectivity, I think, is very important part and perspective, because for example, in my case, for example, if we speak about this product, means I know this product. Yeah, I launched this product, developed this product. So like I know it out. So sometimes we don't have a fresh perspective in looking at this in this process, right? There is an example where we position our product as in the biopharmaceutical terminology, like moisturizers or emollient of urea-based product. When we said urea-based product, we narrow our mindset only skewed towards urea market. We can say, let's say, 1 million. This is just an example. But when we engage another consultant, right, when we engage facilitator recently, this facilitator give us a unique perspective where he said that, hey, Dr. Steven, a minute. Moisturizers is moisturizers, and it's not only about urea. Many other moisturizers in the world that patients also use. Moisturizer based on this, based on that, based on that. And if we try to encapsulate all these moisturizers available in the market, we can say it's actually natural-based product. So when we said urea-based product, our mindset is very narrow, skewed towards the urea-based product. And so the opportunity...
Urea saja gitu ya, only in that.
Yeah, the perspective, and suddenly the market becoming bigger, the opportunity is bigger. Yeah.
Yeah, betul. Now, think as I'm so happy when you're saying you need facilitators, especially in three areas: bridging, setting objectives, sama creating fresh or alternative perspectives, yeah? Really seeing things from a very different perspective. And actually, those are the challenges that facilitators are giving, gitu kan, to the panel or to the board, and also to decision makers, gitu kan. Kadang-kadang, because you're the facilitators are coming from neutral zone, they can challenge you. They can even challenge you stronger compared to somebody from inside. Karena somebody from internal company, a lot of time it's a political issues. Gitu.
Yes,
should I say moreover, it? Should I not say it?
Yes, moreover, in the company, there's hierarchy, right? So for example, when I throw an idea, my manager tend to just accept it, right? They don't dare to challenge the idea coming from me, because they feel that, oh, but you're the global director, so you know much more than me. But if we involve other people whose objective from outside, fresh perspective, then he can come back and challenge, Steven, think, wait, let's put aside and then let's do like this. So in that meeting, for example, me and my manager or even my supervisor, we are sitting at the same position because we're discussing about certain topic facilitated by someone who doesn't have any rank or job hierarchy to us, right? So it's more objective. It's nicer.
Right, right. ini mau say hi juga, ada Mas Bambang di sini. Mas Bambang is also dealing a lot with community development. He's one of a very good old friends of us. Ada Mbak Juni, ada Steven Agustina. Steven is also dealing with training and facilitation. He wants to learn how to be a facilitator, and I will be happy to be his mentor. Hopefully that he's growing to be one of the facilitator. Now, anyone of you who are joining in, teman-teman yang ada di sini, silahkan kalau ada pertanyaan pada Dr. Steven atau pada saya, silahkan dituliskan di chat ya, supaya kemudian saya bisa membacakan juga untuk Dr. Steven. Anyway, kalau kita ngelihat, if we see this process ya, you becoming an international global director, sebetulnya international, one of the largest pharmaceutical company in the world, tapi juga become the youngest person in the position gitu kan. Seringkali knowing how the pharmaceutical, especially in Europe sebetulnya, somebody who is very young coming from foreign countries gitu ya, Indonesia gitu kan, ya, yeah, how do you maneuver inside? Because are you barging in masuk aja gitu, blum blum blum, here I am gitu ya, and how do you or is there any way you're doing it and what might be the apa ya, the interesting experience that you are dealing with, and I can sense that you are also a facilitative person. So how do you facilitate that way, getting into the communication, relationship, yeah, dealing with day-to-day managerial issues with people who might be longer in the company and who, yeah, might be higher in position? How do you, yeah, maneuver?
Yeah, so I think it's very, very true that especially when we are younger than the average age, in some company, I would say company age is no longer an issue, but still in some other company, they see hierarchical based on age perception. Age might represent how long you're in the industry, how many experience you've got. But so that's why I know it's challenging. Of course, when we climb up or entering certain responsibility, right? So even in my case, I also foresee that. But usually, if I can give a little bit of a tips, right? Because everyone for sure have a different, character or personality in order to enter certain community or institution levels and everything. But for me, I know someone who just come in and is like, I'm the smartest here, so everybody listen to me. I have this director's position anyway. But I know someone did that, but that's not my forte. So usually if it's me, but also I know another extreme, someone who just come and then despite they have a rank or they have responsibility, they just silent is gold, observe and relatively speak nothing, right? And after the meeting he write everything. I know some people do that, so they really don't speak but they write everything. I think let's try to be somewhere in the middle, you know, to have a good balance. When I enter certain institution or corporation or certain level or position, usually I would suggest to really at the first time being humble and just observe first. Because of course, we don't know many things, right? As a new person entering that area, many people have more years of experience for as compared to us, which we have to respect. We might have the academic background, but everyone have academic background. So I think there is a lot of this, I would say, balance between being humble, being respect to others, and just observe first. When usually I never, I would say, or to say the least, very seldom make comments in my first meeting with, when I enter such new company or new position, right? I would like to observe first. After two or three meeting, and I start realizing, okay, this person maybe like this. As you know, Pak, in the leadership development, we also learn about mapping the people characteristic, right? The psychological of people, right? So I think this is also very important, because when we start do the map, okay, these guys, okay, this one. So most likely we have to approach this way. These guys like this, okay. Then once we understand the dynamic, right, I think we can act properly. I think that's, and act properly, it's very important in order to be accepted, right, in the organization. So, and the better we manage these things, then I think the better they accept you, they feel you part of the family or part of the game, instead of someone just entering and being just like a small shark chasing the other fish around, right? So I know that there is story about this small shark in the fish tank. So, but of course, at the same time, I believe many fish doesn't like this shark because so I think it's a balance of being also part of the family, and you know, so and I think it makes just life and work life more enjoyable, because in the end, we spend 8 hours in the office, like 1/3 of our life with our colleagues, with our team, our people. So we have to enter wisely, being humble, and once we grasp everything, we understand the situation, then we can do a little bit more. Yeah.
Thank you. That's a good answer for simple how to get into this company's being youngest and going all the way up. Is being humble and observe at the beginning, but then map the people, really map the people who are in the meeting room, in the companies, basically. And so once you map the people, you know how to approach them. Once you know the approach, then you
drive slowly according to what you want the team to be shaped, or the objective that we aim to achieve. And then I think that will be much more acceptable by most of the people. Not disruptive to the dynamic of the organization, and then I think that will balance, and I think that will sustain the career also in the organization.
But actually, what you are doing very much like what a facilitator is doing, because when we are entering a meeting room and we're dealing with people within the board of directors or board of commission. Right away, what I do is really being humble, because I'm, compared to them, they are the one who makes the decisions, right? So I'm a facilitator, being humble, observe them, observe, and really map them and really work with them rather than ordering or telling them what to do. Really work with them and allowing them to have space. Because one of the key elements of being a facilitator is creating space for participants, for people within around you to express their thoughts, to come up with even questions or judgment or decisions. So those kind of things become the dynamic of the discussions, right, of organization. So that's the way we are doing as well as a facilitator. And I see that you, being the youngest, and it's interesting because being a young director, you really work it out as you said, being a part of a family. So when I was young professionals, I also come with that approach. I always say, I'm young, I want to learn from you, because I believe you, with your experience, you know better how to do. So I ask them, even though they are my subordinate, anak buah gitu kan. So I still respect that, because they know a lot more than I do. So that's also the model that you are working. Thank you. Now, Doc, 2020 is very unique, right? And with this COVID, and Italy is one of the big hit in Europe during that period, and you are in the middle of that situation. And also throughout Europe and throughout the world, the pandemic is not yet over. How do you see what happened? How do you see the business, especially in pharmaceutical, but also in overall seeing the business world? Yeah, kayak apa sih? What happened to the business world? And what do you see the role of facilitator? Now you know that you are using a lot of facilitators, both internal and external, to work with you in the company. But also, I want to know how you see globally the work of facilitation in any other business as well as in pharmaceutical, currently and in the future.
I think some of the insight I could share, and which already discussed as well at the global level, in I would say most of the biggest global congresses, even recently we discussed with another big global congress organizer, which every year they organize a meeting in Monaco with around 12,000 doctors coming from all over the world. So I think first insight is that we foresee, due to this COVID, I think even some of the publication already write about this, it's accelerate our adoption or our advancement in terms of digital technology absorption or adoption into life. You know, like in 5 years, it's accelerated in 1 year. For example, many, many people never use such webinar facility before. We're not familiar with, for example, Google Meet or Microsoft Teams or Zoom or any of these. But then nowadays, everybody use this because from a very young age group, like they use it for school, they use it for university. Many, many university previously said, no, we don't accept online course. This must be face-to-face. You have to sit in the class and you have to do absent, right? Less than 75%, then you're out of the game. I mean, it's like, that's really cool. But then now, like, which university do lectures without online, right? So it's, I think it's really changed the world. It's accelerate our digital, I would say, absorption into our daily life and habit. And I think most of the expert here also said digital is here to stay. So even in the healthcare business, because, for example, most of the congresses, you may organize the congress, for example, in Bali, but the problem, is there a flight to go there or not? Sorry. Even if there is a flight, the patient or the consumers or the doctors, they want to fly there or not? So so there are many aspects beyond just opening borders or making flights available for everyone. So, and this is what most of the people said, that digital here to stay, even after COVID. Even some doctors previously, even when I was in the medical school, were saying that, no, you cannot serve consultation via online, right? But nowadays, even if you see in guidelines of American Academy of Dermatology or the other, they speak about teledermatology. So teledermatology is like teleconsultation with between medical doctors and the patient. And now they use this because, of course, there's a lot of limitation. You lose the three-dimensionality of the features of the clinical condition. Sometimes we don't use a proper lighting, or the patient don't use proper lighting. Sometimes the internet connection is not good. Sometimes the resolution of the camera is not up to the standard. But nowadays, there's no other option. So that's why, in conclusion, I think first, digital here to stay. And the second one, that's why for most of the business nowadays, we need to really embrace this digital shift, or we will be left behind. So if there is still any opportunity to switch to digital, let's switch to digital, or at least anticipate any innovation in digital space. And the second one, of course, we know that the five letter of Abraham Maslow needs, right? Psychological needs. So of course, in the current situation where maybe I would say money or, you know, buying capacity is really at a challenging situation, of course, then many people go down, right? So we say that people are not necessarily seeking for a cheap product, but people would to have more value for money product. So so delivering value added, I think much more appreciated nowadays. So it's just beyond lowering price, because there is no limit. If you want to lower the price, you can give it for free. But when people don't want to use it, they don't get it. So it's really about delivering value added towards the product, rather than just sacrificing or fight against the price war.
Now that's beautiful. So digitalization here to stay. Embrace digital or anticipate the tools that is within the digital, and in your area is even very unique. Yeah, because a lot of time people are going to the doctor physically, they have to be seen and touched and observed and everything. Now through digital, which is very somehow very difficult, people still need to go to the doctor and to really see and observe. But also, there are some work that could be done earlier, pre-visiting the doctor, that could be done through observation by digital communication. As well as I see that the service by digital doctors is also increased now, because people, like in Indonesia, they have Hello Doc, for example, and people can just ask for simple conditions, not severe, but simple conditions, and they can just ask the doctors, and they have the conversation through communication, like WhatsApp and Zoom.
Yeah.
So it's very, very interesting. Now, you also work with facilitators. Do you think that facilitators will also become more apparent, more used in your company, in your organizations, especially with
I think because the needs from my perspective, the needs is always there, because like what I've mentioned before, as long as you're involving two different perspective or many different angle or backgrounds of peoples and interests and everything, so I think for sure, we will need facilitators, because, and moreover, nowadays, meeting is, I would say, easily held, like this, Insta Live, Zoom, or Google Meet, and then we set, and then suddenly, we don't need to take flight, we don't have to arrive in the airport 2 hours earlier, you're already online with experts from US, from Europe, from Asia Pacific, and then, but of course, in this meeting, you cannot facilitate yourself, because you're representing a company. So, and these audience are professor, experts, academic function, no commercial interest from every country. So you need someone to help you managing this facilitation in order to achieve the objective from both
company
perspective and also from the non-profit or medical scientific or academic perspective. And this could be achieved when we're involving someone objective, transparent, fresh perspective, and someone who can really build the bridge. Yeah.
Wow, that's beautiful. You know, I hear you saying this. I hear some other friends who are coming from also from global companies. He also said the same thing. And I'm so excited, because then now I feel that yes, this is the time when facilitators like me, professional facilitators, can really work. And that's also giving inspiration to the young facilitators who are striving for becoming professional facilitators. The market is there. The market is open. And with digitalization, now people that don't have to fly in, they just click in. It's just like a click over. And then all of the discussion is there, and you need to facilitate the process. It's beautiful. Before we go on, I want to say hi to Adi Brakmanto, good friend, Mas Afif, also Ari, and there's this Mbak Fatma. They say hi, Fatma say hi to you, Dr. Steven. So these friends are having a lot of interest for facilitation. So when you're sharing about how facilitation in global perspective is very much in needs, also especially in pharmaceutical companies, that is encouraging. That's very much encouraging. Now, Doc, how do you see the future? how do you see your future? Where do you want to go after this? Now you are in global, the biggest pharmaceutical company in the world. Now you are also a director, still very young. And then what else? The sky is the limit, and you're reaching close to the sky.
I think it's always my aspiration to share, you know, like knowledge, experience to the other colleagues, right? Because I know, I mean, many brilliant people, of course, as we know from Indonesia, but sometimes could be very, very limited to really come up into the big corporation, especially in a multinational company where I would say in terms of language proficiency must be at to certain level, and in terms of knowledge academic also must be at to certain level to be accepted. So I think I would someday I would really happy to share all these. I'm working I'm completing my PhD program right now in the international entrepreneurship in France. So I think someday, I mean, maybe someday when I stop from this corporation business, of course, I would like to maybe just being lecturers or giving, sharing some of my experience to the other colleagues in Indonesia or let's say international perspective. So I think that's always my vision. And of course, in terms of corporation, of course, the objective is to really make these new ventures within this big global company. It's getting bigger and bigger, launch more in many more countries. So far, we already successfully launched in 13 countries only in 2 years. Pa. So it's very ambitious, aggressive launch. And in the next 12 months, we aim to launch in another 9 countries. So it's very aggressive, but that's part of course, my responsibility. But it's an in mind to achieve. So I think that's some of the things that I would like to achieve in the near future.
Are you writing any books?
I'm not writing. I'm writing many papers, but not in the books yet, because books takes a lot of chapter and it just takes a lot of times. But I'm working with two professor, which is my mentor nowadays in my PhD program, one from Utah, United States, and the other one from California. We're writing some papers as part of the, it's a combination between, it's always interesting to learn about two aspects from the bioethics perspective. So basically, as a non-profit oriented professionals, but on the other hand, pharmaceutical business must make profit, like what I've mentioned before. So there is an element of entrepreneurship there, international. So I try to coin these two perspective and see where it meets the equilibrium. Let's see.
Beautiful, because that's a challenge actually. In a lot of countries, there are this kayak tug of war gitu between being a medical doctor and being manager, even in context of hospital. A lot of hospitals are poorly managed, not because they are not smart people, because a hospital is a combination of everybody from very simple, somebody working in laboratory and just for cleaning service, all the way to the professor doctors, right? In one place. And managing them, a lot of time people say, yeah, udah, give it to the doctor. And a lot of doctors, might be they are very good in education, I mean, in their academics or being a doctor, but not necessarily good in managing. So having this or bringing these two together will be very, very, very important. I think that's a lot of time people see it as a different aspects. Actually, now you yourself is an evidence, living evidence, that you can actually combine the two, being a medical doctor and at the same time also being an entrepreneur. And now even you're reaching your PhD level, which is not only a medical doctor, but a doctor. doctor, which is very, very rare.
Work in progress.
Work in progress. Well, will you be the youngest doctor there is in the world?
No.
Now, Dr. Steven, we have around 8 minutes, the last 8 minutes. What will be your say towards to our friends here, how to bring your career, your aspiration to life since very young? But maybe you share the last sentences, wisdom of how to becoming a very successful young man, at the same time very balanced, at the same time reaching not only in local, but going all the way to international, call antar planet possible. Maybe you are going to antar planet. Gitu. But share with me the wisdom. Share with me the inspiration.
I think if I may share, I mean, this is also based on what personally I've been through. I think, of course, the first step is about building credibility first, Pa. I mean, you know very well, in the international perspective, someone arrives from, let's say, Asia or Indonesia, where the per capita is, let's say, only $4,000 per year as compared to the European country that maybe 8 times or 10 times more. So in terms of economy, in terms of the perspective, the perceived quality of education, whatever, I think the first one, we really need to build the credibility first. That's why I would really encourage for any of young professionals or, you know, like who just graduate or a young generation to really first build the credibility. We must show our credibility. Like sometimes I always said when I was invited also to be the speakers in one of the university, I'm saying that the day I was invited to be the guest speakers during the graduation of one of the university in Bali, and I'm saying that it's not about gaining title, right? Okay, you are Sarjana Economy. You have bachelor in economy. But the question will be, you can defend the knowledge or not, right? Because when we enter the company, it's not about the title anymore, right? The title is used and the IP, the GPA score is used as a screening factor. But once you enter the company, what they test is your real capability. So just make sure that when we study, we also extract the real essence of the knowledge, not only just in order to obtain the degree. That's the first one, Pa. And then I think the second most important, so for me, I mean, being a doctor, I have to defend my doctor's knowledge. So if someone asks me about the hypertension treatment, I have to know it. Someone asks me about diabetes treatment, I have to know it. Someone asks me about the dermatology disease, I have to know it. So something that we must be able to defend. Also the same thing, like, we have held the master degree in business management. If someone asking about the principal concept of segmentation, targeting, positioning, it's a daily bread. So I think when we speak about agile management, when we speak about operational management, when we speak about supply chain management, when we speak about even financial management, managing the P&L of every country, right, from top line to bottom line, we have to master all that things, right? So I think first is really building credibility in terms of knowledge. And the second one, of course, I would really encourage about the language. I know many, many people from Asia, not only Indonesia, sometimes because we did not born with this language, right, with English language. So we are born with maybe Bahasa, with Tagalog, or maybe Vietnam language, or maybe Chinese language. So, which is, of course, it's a foreign language for us to learn, but I think we got to reach at a certain level of standard in order to be able to climb up to the international position. And I've seen many people who have a very good academic, who have very good track record. Sometimes they cannot climb simply just because they cannot communicate properly in English, for example. So I think the international language is very important from my perspective. Me, myself, I keep studying language, Pa. I mean, like, I learned German because I work in German company before for almost 4 or 5 years. And I also speak Italian now because I work in Italian company. So I think language is something that we have to really learn. So I think if we have a very good confident in terms of language and also the knowledge we have, which we can defend, so the capabilities, the credibility that I'm saying before, I think then we just follow the pathway Yeah.
Excellent. So you say it out loud because three things, yeah? Building credibility, defend that capacity. And the third thing is language. Even you learn German, you learn Italian. Buongiorno.
Buongiorno.
But how do you bring that into life is one of the most beautiful thing because it's you. Yeah, it brings from your experience. It brings from your path as well. And I think that is also the same thing with me, with my profession. A lot of time people ask me, Vic, what is your academic? You know, my academic is actually only S1, gitu ya. Economy, just pass the grade and I'm finished. But then I built my credibility from the work that I do as a facilitator. Throughout the years, people start to see what I do, making mistakes at the beginning of the process, but then it becomes more and more, credible for clients. People see what I'm doing, and it becomes, that's where I become one of the facilitators working in Europe and in the region, because not because of my academics, but because they realize that what I do can also, you know, at the same level as any academics in a sense. Yeah. But that's what they call certain condition that they say talent, a certain talent that can help you growing that. But again, language is the capacity that people need to strive in so people can work better. Well, the last minute is I want to say thank you. Meeting Dr. Steven, one of the youngest executives in pharmaceutical company globally, have a wonderful talk with us together, very inspirational, and also giving a lot of tips. So to everybody who is also joining in, thank you very much. I hope that everybody also learned. There are 30 people are joining in, so thank you very much. And also allowing us to express our experience and our knowledge and wisdom. Again, Steven, thank you very much. Stay healthy in Italy. And when you come back, send hi, okay?
Let me know. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.